Hi, it's very gratifying to see you all come tonight. Thanks very much. I'm Teresa Gallarducci, and I'm the director of the Bernard Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis here at the New School. I'm also the chair of the economics department here at the New School for Social Research. So again, I welcome you with those two hats. It is my pleasure to tell you a little bit about our center. It was the Center for Economic Policy Analysis for many years, and it became the Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis because of the generous gift of Bernard and his wife, Irene Schwartz, several years ago. It is dedicated to bringing in critical economic thought, heterodox economics, into mainstream policy making and mainstream policy teaching. And one of the events and signature activities of the center is our Schwartz lecture series, where we've had many people who actually changing economic policy and make real critical economic thinking in the public dialogue come to the New School. Paul Krugman, Laura Tyson, former SEIU president, what's I just forgetting his name? Sorry. What? Randy Stern. I'm sorry, I'm fighting a cold. Have been our former speakers. It is, and Amartya Sen. Oh, and Amartya Sen. Bill Lozonik. So many, many thinkers before Greg Smith and many speakers to come. To fulfill our mission here at the New School and in the center. So I would like to invite the former chair of our department and my colleague, Will Milberg, to introduce our speaker tonight. So thanks very much. Oh, I'm supposed to announce, that as you see that this event will be filmed, it's also Twittered. So those of you who would like to join in on the Twitter conversation, because there are folks here are watching it online as well, please use the hashtag Greg Smith. And for those of you who know about Twittering, know what I'm talking about. And those who don't won't be Twittering either. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Teresa. Thank you, Teresa, and welcome everybody. This is an unusual and exciting event. It's a great event. And I want to thank Teresa, I want to thank Bridget Fisher very much for pulling this together. I want to thank the Schwartz Center and Bernard Schwartz. And we will have tonight a series of activities. First, we will have a talk by Greg Smith, the author of Why I Left Goldman Sachs. And then we will have a panel discussion. And the panel will include Jeff Madrick, who works at the New School Schwartz Center, but also has been a prolific author and commentator on things financial and economic for many years. And we have with us Marianne LeNabat, who's a PhD student in philosophy, but who was very active in the Occupy Wall Street movement and will be contributing along those lines in the discussion. So we're going to have a good panel discussion after Greg's talk, and then we'll, of course, open it up for questions and responses by Greg and the panel. You know, where else but at the New School do you get Occupy Wall Street and a Goldman Sachs derivatives trader sitting next to each other and being quite civil with each other up till now, as a matter of fact? No, quite seriously, I mean, this is an opportunity. This is an opportunity at the New School to bring someone here who has a very interesting experience and take on the recent financial crisis and the financial culture of America, and to engage with us, and to engage with two, you know, very interesting colleagues. So it's a classic New School event, and I welcome you all. This morning I went to grab my copy of Why I Left Goldman Sachs to prepare my introductory comments, and I realized I couldn't find it. I bought three of them, and I kept giving them away. It's a small little book. I recommend it that you buy it. I kept giving them away. You got to read this book, I kept saying to people. You got to read this book. And the question is, you know, we've been flooded with books about the financial crisis. We've been flooded with books about why markets fail. We've been flooded with books about why derivative markets are riven with corruption. Why was this particular book so riveting, so compelling? And I think the media has not been so kind to Greg Smith. The media, in one media outlet, wrote that, you know, there's no information, no specific information on who to indict for what they did when. So what's the use? There's no gotcha moment in the book, which everyone waited for after they read Greg's op-ed piece when he initially resigned. There was no gotcha moment in the book. We couldn't indict. Another media outlet complained, so what's new? Bankers who want money. Greedy bankers. It's a redundant phrase. What's new about that? In my reading, the media has kind of gotten it wrong. They've missed the point of the book, and we'll hear the real story tonight. This is an account that's very deeply rooted in our times. This is an account about our world. It's about America's role in our world, and it's about America's decline and the culture that is surrounding that decline. Greg Smith was a very bright kid from Johannesburg, South Africa, who achieved his dream. His dream was a scholarship to a great American university, Stanford University. He arrived, he observed, he adjusted. He saw American life, he enjoyed American life, he thrived in American life, and he achieved his next great goal. And his next great goal was a summer internship at Goldman Sachs. These were the times. The best, the brightest, the sharpest kids from not only America, but around the world were going into finance when they got out of Stanford, Yale, Harvard. That's where the greatest human capital that America could produce went. So Greg's story is about the allure of the cosmopolitan center that we are part of here at the New School, but which of course includes the buildings to our south. The sophistication of that center, the status, and its location in New York, as I said. This is not to say that Greg Smith is a hero who didn't like the money he earned. And the book, in fact, has a number of points where he complains about his six-figure bonus, too small. But the allure was American business culture. And this is what the book is about. It's about American business culture. And it was about serving clients well and making business work and getting paid well along the way. But it was about serving those clients and doing business right. And so the story is one of the transformation of that culture. The clients who were being served are now being ripped off. And that's the story of cultural decay that we learn in a very riveting narrative that Greg provides in the book. So it's the story of the coming of age of a white kid from Johannesburg, and it's the story of the rise and dominance of shadow banking in our economy and in our culture. And that brings, that economy is one that has brought our economy, our macroeconomy down, and it has really fundamentally altered our culture. It's altered that cosmopolitan allure, which I think brought Greg to New York in the first place. So I'm very pleased that we have the great pleasure of hearing that story firsthand, and we hear it from Greg Smith himself. And after that, we will turn to our panel and have a discussion and a debate, and we'll be able to ask questions. What can we do about it? So please give a warm welcome to our speaker, Schwartz Lecturer for 2013, Greg Smith. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Milberg, and thank you very much to the Schwartz Center for having me. Can everyone hear me? Okay. When I heard that list of former lecturers, I'm in very illustrious company and very grateful to be here. I've been giving these talks around the country, mostly at colleges, and it's been very interesting for me and a real rewarding experience to meet with students. Just to start, can I just get a sense of the audience, who here are undergrads? Grad students and faculty? Excellent. Anyone? Community? Anyone working in finance currently? Excellent. So just to tell you a little bit more about myself before I start, and then I'll give you a roadmap for what I'm going to cover. As the professor said, I'm originally from South Africa. That said, I came to America when I was 18, lived in California for 4 years. I lived in New York for 10 years. I lived in London for a year and a half. So my accent is very varied and a little bit strange to some people. So when people ask me where I'm from, at times I just give the answer I'm from Brooklyn. And it really throws them off. And when they get extra confused, I say I'm from East Brooklyn, and that even throws them off even further. But no, I hope everyone understands the accent. The second just tidbit about myself, I actually started at Stanford as a pre-med and was doing the business track and the pre-med track simultaneously, and ultimately ended up going the business route. So that's just a little bit about me. Now, let me tell you the three things I'm going to try to cover before we get to the panel. The first thing is, many people ask the question, what has really ever changed on Wall Street? Wall Street's always done things a certain way. They've always been dubious practices. Has anything really changed? The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you from the time when I joined in 2000, what did change. You know, everyone remembers we had the SNL scandal. We've had all sorts of crises. Yet the one that occurred in 2008 almost caused another Great Depression and brought the global economies to its knees. And I'm going to give you my own perspective of the things that changed that got us there. The second thing I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about how banks actually make money. And, you know, if any of you watch a JP Morgan commercial on TV or a Goldman Sachs commercial on TV, you would get the impression that these banks are in the business of helping rebuild New Orleans or reaching out to urban communities. And what I would say to you is this is a very misleading thing, and it's very frustrating to me when CEOs go in front of Congress and really are trying to take this position that they're keeping the U.S. markets as the best and most liquid in the world and all the good they do for society. Now, don't get me wrong, there is a place for banking to do things well, but the way the model is today, it's completely out of whack. And really the journey I try to take people on in the book is to show how this mindset changed from what the professor alluded to, this kind of long-term serve the client and they'll keep coming back to you mentality, to this real win at all costs, swing for the fences mentality. And a very clear example, which we've had quite recently, I'm sure many people remember, a guy named the London Whale, who worked for JP Morgan, lost $6 billion for the bank. Him and his boss got wrist slaps. They'd both gotten between millions and tens of millions of dollars of bonuses, and they just left the firm. Now, this is very signifying of the mentality where the profits really, at this point in time, get privatized to a few people who are encouraged by their incentive systems to swing for the fence. And when things go wrong, let's say that loss had been $200 billion instead of $6 billion, what would have happened? The taxpayer obviously would have been called to bail the bank out. And what would have happened to those traders? They would have probably gone, left the job, maybe started a hedge fund. You know, we can look at the list of people that were running the major firms in 2008, Jimmy Cain, Stan O'Neill, Dick Fuld. You know, there was one trader named Howie Hubler who I think lost $12 billion in 2 days. And these people are all still very wealthy and have all moved on to things that are still generating wealth for them. So I'm going to try to tell you a little bit today why and how this incentive system arose. And then the final thing I'm going to talk about is why has not enough been done to fix this? And just out of curiosity, who in the audience has heard of the Dodd-Frank Act? Now, if any of us had watched the presidential debates, we would have seen the Obama administration tout the success of this great financial reform, which has fixed all the problems that occurred during the crisis. How many people think 5 years after the crisis and 2.5 years after the act was passed that it's actually been implemented? So it has not been implemented. And you know, one of the things I try to get across, and I think one of the most important things I want to get across to people is politicians do not want you to hear this. They want to give the impression that landmark financial reform has been passed. The truth is less than one third of the rules have been implemented and more than three quarters of the deadlines have been missed. And during this time, banks have spent close to $400 million trying to kill the major rules that, in my opinion, would prevent another crisis from occurring. And this is a very frustrating thing to see, especially when I go around and give talks. I don't think most of the country knows this, in that I think politicians ran on this idea that things have been fixed. But I'm going to talk about, in this third part of my talk, you know, why it hasn't been fixed. And I'm sure a lot of you will guess it has a lot to do with what many people call the revolving door between Washington and Wall Street. You know, you have Arthur Levitt, the former head of the SEC, now works for Goldman Sachs. Many people remember Pawlenty, who was an aspiring presidential candidate, dropped out of the race and went to run the biggest bank lobby in the country. And this is very problematic, and it is very, I would say the public should be outraged by it, because it does not serve us well when this door continues to spin. So let me start with the first point. What has changed? And many people ask the question, Wall Street's always been bad. What I'll tell you is when I joined Goldman Sachs in 2002, the firm was making about $5 billion in the trading business. By the time 2007 rolled around, the firm was making $36 billion. Now, revenues don't quintuple or multiply by six or seven unless there's been some meaningful change. And there were three very specific things that occurred, which politicians don't like to talk about, but effectively were lobbied on the down low without much media coverage. And I think the financial media, in my opinion, deserves a lot of fault for not uncovering these things while they were happening. But first thing was in 1999, a thing called the Glass-Steagall Act, which was implemented in the 1930s, really to separate commercial banks, which take our retail deposits, from trading houses. This was overturned, and it was largely pushed by the Sandy Wiles of the world, who were trying to build up what became known as these giant banking supermarkets. And you know, we had Citigroup, we had JP Morgan Chase, and this rule was overturned during the Clinton administration. Second major thing that happened that I would bet 99% of people have never heard of this act was a thing called the Commodity Futures Modernization Act. And what it effectively did is it took complex securities, which at times you need a PhD in physics to understand, and it deregulated them. And in the year 2000, derivatives were taken out of the light of day, off exchanges, into the dark. And ultimately, what did this lead to? We all know the initial runs on Bear Stearns, on Merrill Lynch, on Lehman Brothers, had a lot to do with the fact that no one had any clue what derivative exposure they had on. It was all in the dark, it was not regulated, it was not reported to anyone. So this moment was pivotal in what I think ultimately led to the crisis. And the final thing was the overturn of another rule which most people have not heard of, called the net capital rule, which basically meant there was a limit on how much leverage you could take. Now, for non-economics people, you know, leverage, just like we'd apply to our daily life, is how much risk you're taking with the money you actually have. So in the early 2000s, banks were betting or trading or taking risk with maybe $5 or $6 against the $1 they had in their wallets. And the $5 or $6 were being borrowed. When this rule was overturned to very little coverage and was largely lobbied by the CEOs of the five biggest banks, leverage ratios went up to 35 or 40 to 1, which basically meant that banks were now betting or borrowing $40 for every $1 they had. So by the time the crisis rolls around, everyone, number one, is panicked because no one knows what risk people hold. And number two, no one has the money to fund these bets that have gone wrong, because if you only have $1 in the bank and your $40 bet has gone wrong, it causes major panic and major crisis. So those are the three structural, what I call Congress-related things that occurred. Now, What does this translate to when a Goldman Sachs trading business revenues go from $5 billion to $35 billion? And by the way, when I joined the firm and joined Wall Street, Wall Street made at least half its money in the original reasons finance is called finance. They financed things. They raised money for corporations. They helped advise companies on merging. They helped advise people in managing their money. When these banks see that they can now bet $40 with every $1 they have, they can now trade these complex securities that customers often don't understand, they start seeing their relationship with the client very differently. So when I talk about client, I'm largely talking about the institutions that control hundreds of billions of dollars of assets in the markets. And one perception I'd also like to clear up is I think that there is a perception that Wall Street is about fat cat bankers that are potentially gambling with other people's money. But something I'd like everyone to know is hedge funds, which one could classify as rich people's money, account for less than 5% of the assets in the markets. The overwhelming majority of assets are things like teachers' retirement funds, firemen's retirement funds, the mutual funds that manage all of our 401ks, sovereign wealth funds, university endowments. The New School has an endowment. And these are the people that, you know, are ultimately at risk with a lot of these things. So, you know, when people start seeing the client not so much as a partner, but as an adversary, where you can now use the information you're getting from the client in order to make your own bets more smartly, we get into a very problematic scenario. And, you know, let's just list a lot of the scandals that have occurred just in the last year and a half. Many of you have heard of a Chicago futures brokerage called MF Global, which essentially $1 billion of money just went missing. It was alleged that the firm, which was run at the time by John Corzine, who many people will remember as a former head of Goldman Sachs, then a governor and senator from New Jersey, the firm was essentially taking its own proprietary bets, which means betting with its own money. And when these bets went wrong, the money couldn't be accounted for, and the firm had to file for bankruptcy. How many people from this firm were prosecuted or indicted? Zero. From what I can tell, I don't think Corzine was even interviewed by anyone within Congress. So this is symptomatic of the risk that has changed. Another scandal many people will have heard about, but again, I don't think is getting enough press. I don't think the financial media is doing a good enough job explaining it, is the LIBOR rigging scandal. Now, LIBOR is an interest rate controlled out of London that is benchmarked to trillions of dollars of college loans, mortgages, things that affect everyone's lives. And essentially, there were eight banks who every day were somewhat conspiring to set these rates based on what would help them make money. And again, Timothy Geithner, the outgoing Secretary of the Treasury, apparently knew about this as early as 2008. And, you know, this only really made it to the surface and to the public's ears in 2012. And still, there haven't been many prosecutions. You know, the list can go on and on and on. HSBC with money laundering, the Facebook IPO, which is a little bit, one could say, less egregious than money laundering, but certainly, you know, you could blame Morgan Stanley, you could blame NASDAQ, you could blame Facebook for being too greedy, but many investors lost half their value just because the IPO, the initial public offering price, was not, in my opinion, represented in a fair way to the public. So these are a string of some of the scandals. Let me move on to the second point, which is how do banks use these changes of regulations to make so much money and to bet with their own money? And the analogy I like to think of is a real casino. Now, in today's day and age, even though banks like JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs don't want people to know this, approximately 70 to 80% of the profits are being made in the trading business today. So this is a huge shift from the beginning of the decade where the majority of profits were being made in the old world banking model. So I compare that trading business to a casino. whether people like real casinos or not, or whether you like gambling or not, I would actually argue casinos today are better regulated than banks. And I'll tell you why. If a casino gets over-leveraged and manages their business badly, we all know the government is not going to let them go out of business. Casinos never become so big that they're going to be systemically dangerous to the rest of society. That's the first thing. The second thing is there are cameras all over the floor. Now, when I talk about derivatives and the fact that they were deregulated, essentially what it's like is you see a suspecting gambler walk into the casino. Now, I would use a teacher's retirement fund or a philanthropy. An example that has struck me a lot recently has been the Red Cross Society. Just as a hypothetical example, we recently had the hurricane in New York, and we'll see commercials on TV about how we should give money to charities. What I don't think a lot of people know is every charity has a fund that they then invest with Wall Street. And a lot of the time, these are the unsuspecting clients who are charged $5 or $10 million in fees in this dark room that's smoke-filled, without a camera, without anyone supervising it. And then a bank will turn around and say, well, we're giving $3 million to the Red Cross Society, or we're donating. And I saw over and over in my career, this at times was less than the amounts of money that banks were actually extracting from these societally important institutions. So that's a little bit about why I think you need cameras. The other reason is Lehman Brothers, Merrill Lynch, AIG, they were taking huge risk, and they were doing it in a dark room, and someone was making a lot of money. You know, in the case of the mortgage crisis, many people have heard of a hedge fund called Paulson and Company, a guy named John Paulson, no relation to Hank Paulson, who made $1 billion on the mortgage market collapsing. On the other side of the trade were some national banks of Germany and Holland, who essentially, in my opinion, were not given full disclosure about a lot of these deals. And many people might remember Senator Carl Levin had a very high-profile hearing in 2010 when Goldman Sachs was sued by the SEC for fraud. And at this hearing, what you heard from Lloyd Blankfein, the CEO, and what you heard from any number of bankers, and frankly, what you'll hear from any CEO of any bank, is that everyone's a big boy, and we're all sophisticated investors. If the government classifies you as being allowed to trade in these products, it's essentially a free-for-all. We owe them no fiduciary duty. And fiduciary duty is something that sounds like a boring term, but I think it's a very important one, and I think we need to return to a world which is longer term oriented and really aligns your interests with your client making money. And if your client's not making money, you should not be making a lot of money either. And that's what fiduciary duty is. And essentially, when all these CEOs testify in front of Congress, they say, well, we owe no fiduciary duty by the legal letter of the law. Now, when I heard this defense, and I talk about a story in the book, right after the SEC hearing, the firm asked me to fly to Singapore to meet with the government, who was a big client of the firm. And I watched this hearing in my client's mother's living room, which is a very surreal experience because it was the middle of the night. And you just essentially heard this argument over and over again. We don't owe our investors anything. They're sophisticated. They know what we're doing. And I had never heard this before because, frankly, this argument as a salesperson whose job is to win the trust of clients and have long-term relationships with them, the idea that this was a win-lose game where we were trying to extract the maximum amount of wealth out of them, this was not the way I'd operated in my own world. In my own opinion, if I had sold toxic deals to clients over and over again, they probably would have not wanted to be my client anymore. But this was a brave new world of people claiming that we no longer owed clients anything. Now, the big misconception, and what I would tell you I'm very certain of, is that when the Oregon State Teachers Retirement Fund or Notre Dame Endowment or Wesleyan Endowment or the New York Teachers Police New York Police Fund comes to Morgan Stanley or Goldman or JP Morgan, they are not approaching this with a caveat emptor, buyer beware, I'm going to get ripped off. These are people who unfortunately do not have the same resources as banks and as hedge funds and are expecting some advice, yet got to a point where they were no longer getting advice. They were getting what I would call used to extract wealth out of. Now, how does this fit into the casino analogy? This misconception, I think, plays it out if one thinks of a blackjack table, where, you know, when we sit down and we see the dealer, we probably think the dealer at worst as being an objective counterparty who is not going to actively try to steer you wrong. Now, think of a game of blackjack. If you are sitting on 19, everyone knows you're supposed to get 21. Would many people in this room expect the dealer to encourage you to hit or take another card, knowing that anyone who knows anything about statistics, and certainly there are people who hit on 20 and just mess up everyone's hands, but the dealer, I would say, if they were doing their job, would tell you this is not a good idea, you're going to ruin everyone else's hands. I think the problem on Wall Street is people walk into the casino and they're often told to take another card on a 19. And the defense for this is, well, they should have known better. Now, I would say to you, you need some kind of fiduciary duty where it's made explicitly clear to people that the firm may have a perverse incentive, they may be betting against you, they may be selling you a product that's so complex that you need two PhDs in physics to understand it. But this is not the case. These products are often presented as great products with real potential for gains, and buried on page 52 of the disclaimers at the back of the book are some of the risks listed. And I would argue many customers of Wall Street do not understand this. So the other point I would make just about this asymmetric information advantage I'm telling you about is the fact that in real casinos, the dealer is not allowed to bet once they've seen everyone's cards. Now, proprietary trading, what that essentially is it's seeing everyone's cards, meaning you have a hedge fund, a mutual fund, a pension fund, all sitting at your table. You see what everyone's got, and then you place your own bet. And you're the only one at the table who can see what everyone's got. And that's exactly what proprietary trading is. It's using your position as being in the center of the market and seeing what everyone's doing and then placing your own bets. Now, we wouldn't expect people to lose very often if they could see everyone's cards. And you know, anyone who invests in the stock markets will know that if you're making money 50.1% of the time, you're a genius investor, you're probably outperforming most people. There are quarters, and this is borne out in mandatory releases that banks have to release, where they will make a profit 100% of the time. Every single day of the quarter, their trading book is generating a profit. Now, that's a little bit like batting 1,000 every time you go up to the plate, you're hitting. And you have to ask yourself, how on earth can you literally make a profit every day if you're not using your position as being in the center of the market to place your own bets? Now, you know, you will hear the likes of a Jamie Dimon, the CEO of JP Morgan, or a Lloyd Blankfein, or a James Gorman of Morgan Stanley, all saying, well, we're very supportive of Dodd-Frank. What you will then hear them say is they're very not supportive of a thing called the Volcker Rule, which many people have heard of Paul Volcker, the former chairman of the Fed. The idea of that rule is designed to basically outlaw or eliminate proprietary trading, meaning betting with the firm's own money. Wall Street has spent hundreds of millions of dollars trying to kill this rule, and what was a little bit counterintuitive to me is the way you kill a rule in today's day and age is not by getting it removed from the bill, it's by lobbying the hell out of it and getting hundreds of exemptions and pages installed to the point where it goes from one page to 700 pages and the regulators get so bamboozled and the law becomes so long that it effectively becomes useless because no one can understand it, no one can follow it. And years after Paul Volcker proposed this rule, the House Republicans are now floating an idea to completely kill the Volcker Rule. Now, what I would tell you is, in my mind, the Volcker Rule is arguably the most important thing that needs to be put in place to prevent another crisis. Yet, what I don't think the American public knows is that this is the very rule that has effectively been killed. The other big rule, which I talk about, is derivatives being taken out of these dark rooms and put into the light of day on an exchange. The CFTC, which is mandated to do this, is still dragging their feet. They have not implemented this. The SEC, as I said, has missed 75% of the deadlines. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is Congress essentially just wrote a framework for Dodd-Frank, and then they gave it to the regulators and said, go write the rules. And the regulators, unfortunately, have proved completely, I don't think incompetent is a too harsh of a word, at actually, number one, understanding the complexity of the business, and number two, knowing how to push back and really do right by the public and write the rules that Congress wanted to be implemented. And what I would tell you is these things have not been implemented. Obama recently appointed a new head of the SEC who effectively was a defense attorney for banks and now has gone to the SEC. And I think what I'm getting the sense of it, it's a little bit more of the same. Unlike the great crash of the late 1920s, when there was a thing called the PCORA hearings, where banks were really dragged in front of Congress and Congress took it upon themselves to understand these businesses, this has not happened at all. And years after the crisis, regulations have not been implemented and this lobby has won. Now, the final point is, why has this happened? And the truth is, and we know that campaign finance riddles everything in our daily lives, from health insurance to the beverage industry to fast foods to defense contracts. And finance is a huge example. You look at the Senate Banking Committee, who are the people contributing to the campaigns of the very people that are supposed to be regulating them? The biggest contributors to most of their campaigns are people who work at J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley. And unfortunately, there are not enough politicians who are willing to do the job that we send them there to do. And, you know, I would single out Elizabeth Warren, who's a senator from Massachusetts, newly elected, who has been one of the few people who people may have seen in recent weeks, has really asked questions to both prosecutors. Number one, why has no one been prosecuted for the financial crisis? And some people may have seen the Frontline documentary, but not one single person has been prosecuted for something that destroyed, by some metrics, 40% of the world's wealth. And you have to ask yourself the question, is that because our Justice Department is complicit in this? Is it because they don't understand the business? Or is it because the rules are just not strict enough to be prosecuted? And for whatever it is, Elizabeth Warren asked these hard questions, and none of the regulatory agencies or prosecutors could give a good answer. So that's happened. And, you know, the second major problem, and the thing I'll conclude on, the third thing, in addition to proprietary trading and derivatives, that I think needs to be fixed, is this idea of too big to fail. And what I think, I'm not sure how many people in this room know this, but the five biggest banks in the United States are now bigger than they were before the financial crisis. So anyone who thinks that Dodd-Frank has magically fixed too big to fail, that has absolutely not happened. Banks, and privately people on Wall Street know this, operate with the assumption that when government and the public looks into the abyss, like we did in 2007, people who preach on about free markets do not actually believe in what they think, meaning they're not going to let these banks die. And as long as banks can borrow money at risk-free rates and borrow almost endless amounts for zero, and the government is not willing to understand their businesses, the opacity of it, the complexity of it, this is just going to keep happening. And you look at profits from 2011 to 2012, they tripled at banks. And I think the public is not given the correct perception, because you'll keep hearing from an Obama or a Romney or anyone else that we passed landmark financial reform and we need to let the free markets function. What I would say to you is I believe in free markets, but I don't believe today we're operating in a free market. I think what a free market pre-assumes is, number one, an even playing field for everyone who's playing in the market, and number two, true competitiveness, where everyone understands the rules of the road. And what I would tell you is that is not taking place. Many people remember in the summer of 2010, there was a thing called the flash crash, where the market essentially dropped 10% in 2 seconds. No one could explain it. It then bounced all the way back. Certain stocks went from $25 to 1 cent. And this evokes a lot of fear in the public. And you look at, if anyone watched CNBC today or yesterday, you'll see that stock markets are at 7-year record highs. What I would tell you is the metrics that measure who has participated in these gains, it has not been the general public. After the crisis and after flash crash in 2010, the public has stayed away from the markets. It's largely been corporations buying back their stock. It's been financial institutions participating. But I still think there's a perception in the public that markets are not fair, that they're not free. You know, one of the ways I end my book is essentially implying and stating that the markets are rigged to an extent. And I think until we point the finger back at our politicians and say, it is your duty to understand a complex business. If you can't understand it, you need to take steps to fix it in order to serve the public well. And there's been a growing consensus of breaking up banks. And I would say more mainstream thinkers are advocating for it. And I would say I'm advocating for it. I think if you split banks into a trading house, a banking house, a retail bank, I think they'll operate more smoothly. They'll be far less systemically dangerous to society. And frankly, it may actually be good for their business. And the last thing I would say is anyone who follows stock markets will know that the way investors are valuing investment banks is below liquidation value, which is telling you even investors don't like the fact that there's no transparency in this business model. So unfortunately, and I'm interested what my fellow panelists feel about this, what banks, in my opinion, have evolved into is almost a mechanism for the top 1% at the banks to extract tens of billions of dollars of bonuses out of without really rewarding shareholders. And you look at a lot of these stocks over the last decade, they've essentially done nothing. They have not posted any gains. Yet during that time, there have been tens of billions of dollars of bonuses extracted out of these companies. So what I would say is banking needs to get back to its original reasons for existing. It needs to become a more boring business. And I know this is a hard thing for Congress or politicians to tell bankers, but I think we as a public should be a little bit more informed and a little bit more angry that our politicians or elected representatives are not doing enough to simplify banks and make them safer for society. So on that note, I'll end my comments and looking forward to the panel.
Thank you very much, Greg. That was fantastic and puts a lot of detail on the plate for the panelists. There was one anecdote in the book that I was hoping you would tell because it was, I have to admit, my favorite, which is when John Taylor, Greg's economics professor at Stanford, would teach the theory of comparative advantage, which I've done about 250 times myself. He would dress up in a, I believe it was a chicken costume.
No, it was a grape. He dressed up as a grape.
A grape, that's right. So I'm sorry. It was a fruit, not an animal.
Yeah.
He dressed up as a grape, and I enjoyed that myself.
Yeah,
thank you. From the heart of an international trade economist, I appreciated that anecdote. We're going to open it up now. I think I'd like to ask the panelists to speak for a few minutes in response or to broaden the discussion. And do you mind going first, Marianne?
Sure.
Okay, so I'll ask Marianne to go first, and then Jeff, and then we'll have Greg respond, and I'll throw out a few extra questions, and then we'll turn it over to the audience. So, Marianne, the floor is yours.
Can people hear me if I speak here? This isn't a microphone in the room.
Come up here, then.
It's
not. Press it. Maybe
just for recording?
There you go.
How about now?
There you go.
Yes?
Get it closer to you.
I'll try to make this work. I want to thank the Center for the invitation to speak at this panel, especially Bridget Fisher. It's definitely the fanciest panel I've ever been asked to speak at. And I guess I'm sort of here to represent Occupy's position, which is difficult because one of the features of this movement, of course, is that it didn't have leaders, and I had a participation in Occupy that involved the student movement, involved labor struggles in the city, but I'm certainly not, I wasn't actually part of the facets of Occupy that were addressing the financial industry, and I'm also not an economist, so I'm speaking from a certain position of inexpertise in these matters. But I mean, Occupy was interesting because it was multifaceted, it was internally heterogeneous, and including in relation to what it thought the problems were with the financial industry. So it ran the gamut from people who want to end the Fed to people who were supportive of credit unions or supportive of regulation, and all the way to the Occupy Bank Working Group, which wanted to create a new kind of bank, a sort of transparent, more democratically operated bank. Oh, excellent. Oh, wonderful. But overall, there was a significant tendency within Occupy, as well as a lot of the movements that arose in 2011 around the world, to be extremely hostile to and cynical about existing financial and political institutions. In fact, that's why it appeared to have a lack of demands. It had demands patently so from the outset. It wanted a modicum of social and economic and political justice, but it appeared to have a lack of demands because it wasn't really expecting existing political and economic institutions to deliver on those. And they haven't. And I take it that that's what we're here to talk about today, is including asking why that is. And I don't think that it's just a matter of inertia. I mean, you've canvassed some of the reasons in your presentation as to why that is, but I want to sort of ask on a more profound level about that, the reasons. I take it it's because the role that the government has taken upon itself is to serve the interests of industry, including the financial industry, as that industry defines them. So I don't want to have a debate that arose within Occupy about capitalism versus its alternatives, but I do want to press the point that after 2008 and 2009 and 2010 and 2011 and 2012, after this many years of a lack of real response, and of course more and more financial scandals coming to light, one can no longer argue that Occupy is naive in being profoundly skeptical that better regulation or a change in corporate culture or a change in, let's say, business ethics are going to happen or are going to solve this problem for us. So, I mean, there were risky speculative activities and deceptive practices and outright fraud happening before 2008, as we all know. You talked about SNL and talked about Enron, whatever. But what was significant to me about 2008, besides the sheer magnitude of it, was that following the bailout, the banks showed an amazing arrogance, I mean, quite unabashedly and publicly. Total lack of humility, total lack of contrition, lack of gratitude for the bailout that it was receiving. And when it came to the question of regulation, the question of putting an end to the practices that had created these problems in the first place, their position was basically one of adamant refusal. You know, it wasn't even a negotiation, it was forget about it. And we can talk about that arrogance, and we can talk about how it permeates the culture within the banks themselves, and that's a lot of what Greg's book is about. But that is just symptomatic. And what it's symptomatic of is how and to what extent they have consolidated their political power. So it's symptomatic of the fact that they are running the show and they know this. So what I want to ask is, again, is it reasonable for us to expect an increase in regulation and a change in business practices within the banks themselves? Because what brought us to that point was not driven by culture. It was driven, I think, by sort of transparent economic incentives, right? It was made possible by deregulation. And that deregulation, too, was driven by ordinary profit-driven economic incentives. So the industry saw opportunities in derivatives, and it secured the deregulation that it needed in order to use those financial instruments or to use them in new ways. That is rational economic behavior. Just as it was rational economic behavior on Goldman Sachs's part to both short the housing market and then accept 100 cents on the dollar in the bailout money for AIG. So the problem, of course, is that the banking industry effectively, as you were sort of talking about in your presentation, writes the banking regulations. And has for some decades now. And that happens in the form of the revolving door that you talked about, the cast of characters moving from public to private positions. It happens in the form of campaign financing. And I want to know why it isn't naive to think that we can suddenly change that dynamic and use regulation to turn around on the banks and rein them in, even if doing so would serve their long-term interests. And here's the force of that question. The people occupying Zuccotti Park were angry because, you know, among other things, they recognized that their job prospects had evaporated, their prospects of owning a house had evaporated, their educational prospects were coming with the absurd price tag of basically a lifetime of student debt, and political institutions, so governments from both a local to a federal level, were saying that they couldn't do anything about this, right? Their hands were completely tied by economic forces. And then there was a fair amount of condescension as well about how Occupy didn't have the sophistication to present, you know, real specific economic solutions to the problems that we were facing, right? A bunch of 20-somethings in a park. What do you guys know about global finance? Or how the economy works? Well, I mean, that's the thing. Either the government didn't understand either, and that's why it allowed the banking industry to change regulations in the way that it did, or it did understand what the consequences would be and let the banking industry do that anyway. And that, I think, is the real force of what Occupy is pointing out, and I don't see what has changed. So I don't see what's changed in the relationship between the banking industry and government that would allow government-based regulatory solutions to take place. So to summarize, I mean, I don't see how this mess didn't come about by forces native to the investment banking industry in the first place. And I don't see how that industry has or ever has had the kind of relationship with government that would allow government to intervene upon those forces that are native to it. And this is the source of Occupy's mistrust of existing political and economic institutions. It was an instinct that they had, perhaps before they or anyone was able to articulate exactly what the mechanics were of that relationship, but the instinct was ultimately proved right and is continuing to be proved right.
Very good.
Jeff, we're going to turn to you now, and then Greg, you'll get a chance to respond before we have some back and forth.
Well, excellent presentations, really, I must say. My only strong disagreement with Greg is that he's too optimistic. I don't think what you're proposing will come true. I very much agree with Marianne. I myself actually spoke in the echo chamber at the General Assembly at Occupy Wall Street early on, I think the day after 600 people were arrested on the Brooklyn Bridge. And I was always moved by the fact that they were right and those around them were wrong, not least Mayor Bloomberg, who told them, go live by your ideas. It always struck me as the great metaphor of the time, because Mayor Bloomberg lived by $200 million in campaign contributions from his own wealth. I think that in a way suggests, that in a way clarifies the misunderstanding here. There's an awful lot that Greg covered, and I think the essence of what Marianne talked about. I do want to say I write a column for Harper's Magazine. I just wrote one saying that Zuccotti Park did not fizzle. It was stopped by the authorities. I mean, it was an overt police process, well thought out. It's been thought about clearly since 1999 and the WTO protests how to deal with these kinds of things. So, unfortunately, it's not on the web, but think about that a little bit. Because protest is being suppressed in America. And protest has been a very important source of change in America. Not only protest with police acquiescence, but civil disobedience as well. So we ought to get the history of America very straight here. We have won many of our most important reforms and human rights through protest, not just the democratic ballot. So I want to say that in favor of Occupy Wall Street and what it stood for, and essentially they were right. Quickly then, even if we passed Dodd-Frank, even if we implemented Dodd-Frank, and judging by what you yourself are saying, Greg, we wouldn't be getting at much of the heart of the matter. I love your metaphor about how can you not win if you see all the cards? The dealer doesn't even see all the cards in the casino, right? That's what happens on Wall Street. Dodd-Frank, as far as I can tell, can't change that. You call it asymmetric information in the Joe Stiglitz School of Asymmetry and Kenneth Arrow School. But it's really inside information, pure and simple. And there's nothing in Dodd-Frank that's going to change that. I believe hedge funds, by and large, have many big hedge funds have access to similar information. I don't know if it's apocryphal, but I put it in my book. I don't think it is in my book, Age of Greed, which is a history of financialization since 1970. And one household name hedge fund manager wouldn't hire, or so he claimed, anybody from Goldman Sachs because he couldn't tell what the record was based on because they had all that information in front of them. What kind of, now the problem is we might sit around and say, so what? So they cheat. So these guys make billions of dollars and they give a little money to charities. Actually, they mostly give money to buildings named after themselves, in case you haven't noticed that. But the problem is this misdirects capital in America away from useful purposes, away from useful investment, towards more and more speculation and more hedging, ridiculously inflated housing prices across America and across Europe. And that is the main problem. Dodd-Frank was not created in the rather, forgive me for being a little strong about this, but I'm almost as angry as Marianne, in the rather weak minds of the Bush administration treasury officials and the Obama follow-ups. It was not created to redirect capital towards productive uses. It was created to put fingers in the holes of the financial community to stop the next crisis. The far bigger issue is how do we redirect capital to productive uses? I'd love to get your thoughts on that, Greg. We have to think about that big time. So it's not remotely only Dodd-Frank's not being passed or even the Volcker rule, and I completely agree with Greg on this, being watered down to almost meaninglessness probably ultimately. It's a very big set of issues. Just a couple of other points, because obviously we could discuss so many of these issues all day. The role of the economics profession. This is an economics forum. Where were the economists? And Greg alluded to it. He said he probably believes a little more in free markets than I do. But you believe in free markets if they're competitive and if they're open. You have a line in your book that stuck out to me. It was like bleak, in bold type, just bleeding red. The highest profit margins were in the least transparent products. Now, going back to Adam Smith and probably earlier, the obligation, the crux of the way markets work is that information is open. We know what the prices are. We know what's going on here. And here, Wall Street exploited lack of transparency, especially in the derivatives market, but I assume in other areas as well. No, now, the Dodd-Frank's supposed to take care of that. That's been watered down as well. Where were economists talking about lack of transparency? Nowhere to be seen for the most part, almost entirely, frankly, until the crash. Where are economists talking about these absurd levels of fees, 5% and 7%, when you started out in the late 1990s on high-tech IPOs? Wasn't there some suspicion that there was a lack of competition among Wall Street firms when fees are absurdly high and promote over-speculation? Where was Wall Street on the blatant conflicts of interest of ratings agencies, which violated the most conservative, Milton Friedman-like principles of economics. Where the heck were they? You say, well, what can economists do? Why should they? Well, the economists took a big stand on NAFTA and free trade. Your friend. Not all of us, of course, love John Taylor as much as you do at the,
well, he was, at the New School. At one point, he was going to be the next chairman of the Fed, but something got messed up.
Fortunately, we stopped
that. Yeah, yeah.
You know, he's a big critic of the of fiscal stimulus. So let me wrap up there. Let Marianne let Greg answer some of these points. Let me see if I should make one more before the end of this. I think I won't. I think it would be time to add some comments along the way. So let me throw it to you.
Thank you.
Great comments. Thank you both of you for your comments. And I want to turn it over to Greg if you want to respond. You don't have to. Go ahead.
Yeah, just to respond briefly. Is this on? Yeah. Thank you both for your comments. I am not in great disagreement with you on a lot of things. And I'll tell you the first one. I'm not particularly optimistic that we're going to get Dodd-Frank or that Dodd-Frank is going to work. I think there are two ways this gets fixed. And this is a very pessimistic thing. But unfortunately, we make the decision as a society to go through this 5 to 7 year cycle where we have bubbles expand and burst, and they get worse and worse. And I think most people thought the 08 crisis was going to be the one that really made people, at least the people that write our laws, take this seriously. And there's that, if things get so bad that there's nothing else that can be done, or there is politicians taking action and actually breaking up banks to make them more safe. Now, I'm slightly... my observation is that there is a slightly greater call for that happening. That said, I'm not very optimistic that that's going to happen. And to Marianne's comments, I completely agree that government is complicit with banks about writing the rules. I think it's an extremely frustrating thing to me. But since I've left the banking industry, I've spent significant amount of time talking to hundreds of people, some in the political world, some in the public. But essentially what we have, to allude to both of your comments, is there are two things that allow people to make a lot of money. The one is opacity, meaning no one can see what it is, or lack of transparency. And the other one is complexity. When people can't understand a system, they can't understand how to fix it. And I would argue government does not understand the system. I think even if they tried, it would be very hard to understand the complexity of some of the derivative products that are traded. I would also tell you, if I had a bet, I don't think Stan O'Neill, who ran Merrill Lynch, I don't think Jimmy Cain, who was on the golf course for most of the time before Bear Stearns went under, I would bet you they did not have a very good understanding of these cash cows that were making a lot of money. And what we essentially have now is what I call a golden goose, which is working very well for people. And I've had lots of conversations with people on Wall Street after my op-ed and after my book. Before I wrote the op-ed, I had dozens of conversations with everyone around me. And to this day, no one privately disagrees with anything I've said. They all acknowledge this is the case. What they agree about is what they disagree about is why the hell are you saying something about this? Because there are a lot of people that are, you know, people say, are people in finance evil people? It's not an easy question to answer, but there are a lot of people who have their kids in private schools, their whole lives are tied up in this world that is very foreign to 99% of the country. But I saw through my own conversations with senior partners, while they acknowledge there's been a massive deterioration and there are significant inequities and the markets are not free and fair, I saw no willingness to ever want to change this. And I think, unfortunately, human greed is something that is very hard to rein in. It's something very hard to fix. And the reason I try to take maybe a more specific approach, and you know, I certainly think protest is a way to fix these things, but unfortunately, politicians are the ones who actually ultimately write the rules. And I think if people are not outraged and are not informed and are not protesting, and I personally thought Occupy had huge potential, and I'm not well versed in how it got shut down, but I do think it's sad that the general public is just not more plugged in, and that Occupy did not get more of a momentum to the point where people were so angry that certainly people are getting billions of dollars of bonuses on a system that no one understands and that our politicians are not willing to fix. So I don't exactly know the way you fix that, but I do think protest, and I do think understanding it and really holding politicians' feet to the fire is part of it. Two other things I would say. The one is the idea of this inside information and hedge funds. You know, we've certainly seen people like Preet Bharara. We've seen various other Justice Departments convict certain hedge fund managers for insider trading. I would say to you that that's the low-hanging fruit, and they're going after the easy stuff. Frankly, one billionaire hedge fund manager who does insider trading is not really affecting us as much as the much greater systemic problem of this whole system that's built on complexity and lack of transparency. And I think, unfortunately, if they sent four or five people to jail that ran some of these banks, I'm not even sure that would have been a thing that would have fixed the problem. I think a lot of people would have said, well, we caught the bad eggs, and it would have been almost a victory lap type thing. I think the problem and the thing I'm trying to get across in the book is that this is a massive systemic problem that goes all the way up to politicians who either are complicit in it or do not do the work to understand how the system works, and is largely based on their campaigns being funded and their own self-interest. It's a very sad state of affairs, and one that I personally hope to educate the thing I would say about Bloomberg is, Bloomberg has a streak of independence in certain realms like gun control and some real outside of the box type things. I think on the financial industry, when his own wealth is tied up, I don't see that same streak of independence. And certainly the Chuck Schumers of the world and a lot of people who are very dependent on Wall Street donations are not showing a streak of independence when it comes to really asking the hard questions. And I think we should hold these people a little bit more accountable to ask those questions.
Just to throw a couple questions back to the full panel, which is, can the public ever be expected to keep up with all the innovation, all the lack of transparency? Is that a realistic kind of goal? And we don't necessarily have to be realistic tonight, but is that a realistic goal for civil society? Can the public really keep up with the madness that we've been hearing about? Yeah, Jeff.
Well, I don't think so. I think the public's been poorly represented in this regard. I don't dislike everything by any means President Obama has done, but I do not think either the Bush administration and the Obama team, which was really a carryover for the most part from the Bush administration, and of course from the Clinton administration, which had more to do with deregulating Wall Street than almost any other administration. They were very determined to make sure the banks stayed healthy. They refused at first, your old boss Paulson refused to do anything about bonuses. The Obama administration did a little bit later, but they didn't do anything on AIG. Let's keep in mind that I think it was Geithner, these things are now fuzzy in my memory, so correct me if I'm wrong. I think it was Geithner who more or less insisted that Goldman Sachs take the AIG money. I mean, Goldman certainly didn't say, no, we don't want it. But that's a huge controversy. And so I simply don't think, we were represented by a Treasury Department and to some degree the Fed. It was by and large had the same values, shared the same values as the people on the street. And a lot of this is this revolving door issue. I don't think it's only that. It's been the dominating factor now, the dominating cultural climate now, since the 1970s. I'm a little prejudiced because I wrote a book about that. You know, it was Walter Wriston who took all that money and lent like crazy in the 1970s to the South America, all that oil money, and then like crazy on easy terms to the South American nations, and we had a crisis in the early 80s. The crises just kept building. And it wasn't only, and led to the SNL crisis and the junk bond crisis, and you know, we had long-term capital management in 1970. So I get the years mixed up by now. We had the East Asian crisis in 1997. These were functions, in my view, of a lack of a vigilant government and very naive ideas about how markets work. Last point, Larry Summers, the esteemed economist, favored the ending of Glass-Steagall, favored the end of derivatives regulation, favored the end of capital controls across across nations. There was all that hot capital that went into South Korea and Singapore and so forth that led to East Asia. There was an opportunity in 1994 to regulate derivatives when Bankers Trust started getting really aggressive and causing losses. In Orange County in California almost went out of business. The Clinton administration didn't quite fight it, but didn't back it either. Let me stop there. I'm sure.
Yeah, Marianne, do you want to respond to this issue of what can be expected of a public in the face of this?
Well, I mean, I think it's important that we distinguish between, you're already distinguishing between like the public and then the government that is supposed to represent their interests. And I don't even know if the problem lies in the fact that the governmental representatives don't understand the complexity of the way that, you know, financial instruments have evolved. For one thing, because there's a sense in which that complexity overruns most anybody's ability to understand it. I mean, you even talk in the book how there's a vast difference between what a salesperson can understand and what a quant can understand, who's actually creating these kinds of derivative products. And for another thing, because again, as in the case with Occupy, you don't necessarily need to know exactly how everything stacks up in order to understand what the sort of power dynamics are, or that there's an enormous problem, or that there's rampant speculation, or whatever, mm-hmm. right? So,
yeah, I would just say on complexity, largely, you'll hear a lot of people defend the merits of complexity and say derivatives add this great value to liquidity in the markets. I would tell you markets function just fine for many decades without complex derivative products. And I don't think anything bad would happen if you outlawed many complex derivative products or if you brought them onto exchanges. I think the reason no one wants that to happen is because so much money is made in the very opacity of them. So I think this argument that liquidity would disappear after having worked in derivatives for 12 years, I don't think is true.
So can this banking system, is there any way to democratize this? I mean, is this a structure that's simply at the whims of the competitive and non-competitive market forces, as Jeff pointed out, or can we imagine some kind of, and you alluded to a small effort that Occupy engaged in, that someone in the audience was involved in, can the banking system be democratized in some way that could bring some justice or even some more socially beneficial reallocation of capital in the way that also Jeff alluded to, that there's this massive misallocation of capital in the economy, which is, you know, has enormous social consequences, not only for our wages today, but for our growth tomorrow, right? Can we imagine a more democratized system? Anyone want to?
You know, I think Occupy was a democratizing factor in America and aroused the nation. But forces lined up against it. The establishment, by and large, lined up against it. And I just don't mean the New York Police Department, which very much evicted, you know, knew that if they evict Occupy from Zuccotti or do not provide Zuccotti a geographical location, you may disagree, that Occupy would be mortally wounded. I think Occupy has lived on. But in any case, I think that's a very important question. Now, democracies, you know, don't always vote the right way historically. Democracies, by and large, for example, have voted in austerity governments. In the United States, austerity economics is, talk about shooting yourself in a vital part. Austerity economics may bring us recession again in 2013, and it's certainly making a mess of Europe. Democracies, for the most part, supported it. Central banks, the non-democratic part of America, by and large, supported much easier policies to try and create economic expansion. Yep. So democratization is a tricky, tricky thing. But shutting down, you know, breaking up the power centers of these banks and starting to have serious capital requirements and ending the obscene bonuses that they get. I mean, they're absolutely obscene. The idea, but Greg has been on the line here, so maybe he, the idea that you make $75 million and therefore you should, as you described, you get 5% of it or 7% of it at the end, you don't make $75 million. There's an entire structure out there on which you're building that. You didn't just devise some product in the hills of Vermont and sell it across the nation, making people happy and make $75 million. You're working, you're pyramiding off a huge structure. The idea that you deserve some you know, fixed proportion of that is absurd on the face of it. So, you know, it's a little bit like people saying TARP made profit. I know I'm citing my resume here, but I have an article in the current New York Review of Books. The idea that you say TARP made a profit when the FDIC raised the guarantee $250,000, guaranteed all bank liabilities. I forget who, the Treasury and the Fed guaranteed all money market and commercial paper. It wasn't TARP alone that operated here. All of us, believe me, all of us making an investment there would have doubled, tripled, or quadrupled our money. The real thing, problem was TARP didn't make enough money. They gave banks ridiculously easy terms.
Yeah, the only thing, I read that article of yours, the other one about democracy and, you know, people voting in austerity. And, I mean, I think it's the caveat that I want to add to that is that when people have voted in austerity measures, it's because they've been very aggressively sold the idea that that is the only viable option available to them. And the fact that, you know, in the United States, the last election, you were effectively choosing between one or another party that was going to give you an austerity program, whether it was popularly supported or not. So I want to add that as a, you know, caveat.
I've just lastly comment on the idea of democratization of the banking system. There are a whole lot of people's wealth who is determined and based on that not happening. And the lobbying you see and the idea of killing the things that the bonuses come from, the reason is because people won't get those bonuses if these rules change. The thing about the point of if you bring in $75 million of revenue, people on Wall Street largely know that there is no product that has been created that is adding anything to anyone. A lot of it is, you know, and I've given a lot of thought to this, and I've tried to write a little bit about it, but there is a fairly direct wealth transferal that's taking place from people's retirement funds into certain bankers' pockets. And the reason it's hard for people to explain this is almost purely because of the opacity and complexity of the system. So if I told you that at the end of your life, when you collect your retirement funds, you may actually have 4 or 5% less, which could be hundreds of thousands or $1 million, purely because a bank is extracting an extra 5% of fees from the mutual fund who doesn't understand the product they're being asked to trade. It's a fairly convoluted way to get mm-hmm. to this wealth transferal, but it's absolutely taking place. And I think that's why, you know, I conclude my book really kind of calling for a return to the original reasons banking existed, which were the ideas of helping facilitate capital movement, helping emerging businesses raise money. But frankly, less than 10% of the money on Wall Street is being made in those businesses. So I think no one who's making tens of millions of dollars in bonuses is going to want to change that system unless people speak out and try to get a change themselves.
So what's stunning is that after the crash, we are, what, four years out, we're right back where we were, right? So what's stunning is that the crash did not lead to any of the types of responses that any of the three panelists are talking about. It let us right. I would say that
unlike Jeff, I would say that this buildup in the 2000s was in magnitude different relative to the size of GDP, and that the financial sector became much more bloated than it was in the 70s, and the misallocation of capital that you referred to became much more egregious. And so therefore, the fact that it's returned post-crisis is just of stunning consequence. And, you know, I think something is different. I think your book is different, by the way, because I do think, while there's been, of course, enormous debate about the crash and the failure of deregulated markets, which, by the way, were deregulated under the guise of increasing competition. Of course, that's how we sell deregulation. That your account is an account of a very specific historical moment. And what's really tragic post your leaving Goldman Sachs is the return to where we are. So the question is has the magnitude reached levels where it's of really more consequence than it was in the 1970s or the 1880s or the 1790s? And at what point? I mean, at what point is there a response? And can this why aren't there more Greg Smiths reacting against it? And obviously the answer to that is quite obvious, but the book is quite remarkable that you've been able to kind of step back from it, walk away from it, and step back and have that analytical perspective on it. Anyone want to comment on that, the magnitude issue?
I'll wait my turn. Yeah, there's no question that, numerically speaking, finance as a proportion of GDP and financial profits is significantly higher than it used to be. What happened in the 1970s is the culture began to change and deregulation began. So that when I say Walter Wriston lent that Arab oil money out willy-nilly, it could have been lent out by government. It could have been controlled by government. The government literally, for example, Paul Volcker wanted to do some of that. Even some people, leftovers from the Nixon administration. But Wriston moved so rapidly and had so much, was such a strong individual, and marshaled forces on his side, and the ideology was changing, that he lent out even before government could act, or it could have been handled by the World Bank. It could have been equity instead of loans and so forth. Ideologically, things changed, but they became huge in the 1970s. Now, they were very big in the 1990s. Yep. I would even argue that this was actually kind of around the time Greg started, so maybe he doesn't have a perspective. I started 1 or 2 years earlier observing this stuff. 1990s were very, very corrupt. No analyst could keep his job without lying boldly. You were there for some of that, I think, because you mentioned it. But lying about these stocks, and you know, it exploded with Enron and WorldCom and all that stuff. But they were lying right and left, and analysts of fame testified before Congress that you couldn't keep your job unless you lied. That was just but one example. The guys who did these IPOs for high-tech companies were basically paying underwriters under the table and compensating the CEOs of these new companies in the late 1990s. It was a remark. And then there were accounting scandals. Whoa, they were beauts. And there were hundreds of them each year. And there might not have been. You know, if it weren't for Elliot,
Spitzer.
if it weren't for Elliot Spitzer, we may not have known any of this stuff. He was almost the only guy we had. And he wasn't using the laws they used. You know, he was very aggressive about the laws, and he'll tell you to this day we have the laws because we have the White Act in New York State, which many are hesitant to use. But what interests me, Will, and then I'll keep quiet. What interests me is how few economists ever looked at the size of the financial industry and tried to measure their contribution.
Yeah,
now,
yeah.
A couple have since.
Since, yes,
the,
but you're absolutely right.
The guy at NYU, remind me his name. But even he, I think, overestimates the value of Wall Street. But by and large, they find that the financial community contributes less and less of value to the economy. It's way too big for what it contributes. My guess is, I wish some economists here at the New School would look into it. A fair analysis of that would show that they're egregiously too large and made egregiously too much money for their contribution.
Marianne, yeah. You want to comment?
Not
Greg?
Right, I'd just say, Spitzer.
And then we'll open it up.
Yeah, you can count on one hand the people like Spitzer who have been brave enough to try to bite the hand that feeds them. And, you know, Schumer is not on that list. Bloomberg is not on that list. Spitzer fixed the internet bubble problem, which was that there was this wall between research analysts who were recommending things just to drum up business for banking. And it was a massive wealth destructor, but he actually got something passed that largely has fixed this problem. People, like Jeff was saying, people think it's fixed. There are some certain ways around it, but unfortunately, I don't think there are enough people. I think Elizabeth Warren is potentially one of the very few people I can think of that even asks a hard question. The other thing I would say is I think the financial media is very complicit in all of this happening. And what I mean by that is that a media, from what I believe, is supposed to ask the hard questions of the sector they're covering. What I experienced after publishing this book was, the professor said, well, there's nothing new here. We all know this happens. Even though there are all these conflicts of interest, this is, you know, we just yawn at this. What I say is that is egregiously irresponsible, because if the public understood these things, they don't yawn at these things. They don't necessarily understand these things. And I think the financial media should be explaining it over and over and over again until it is obvious to people. And this is absolutely not happening. I think the reason no one has gone to jail is because the curbs and the laws aren't strict enough, and that's what the financial media yawns at. And I think it's a very sad state of affairs. The last thing I will just say on the bonus culture is it certainly is a what I'd call a false reality. And I, you know, I talk about in the book, the reason I talk about bonuses is I wanted to give the public or someone not on Wall Street a feel for how people think about these things. And it really is an eat what you kill environment, meaning if you can show $52 million next to your name, they will literally pay you 5 to 7% of that number. Now, unfortunately, the leaders of these firms don't care to ask the hard questions. Was this money being made in the right way? And I went through my own evolution where I started refusing to sell certain deals that could have obviously gotten that number next to my name to be bigger. And I saw some of my colleagues have this own sense of self-reflection. And I certainly drank the Kool-Aid for many years. And the book is trying to show my own evolution of how I started seeing these things being different. But I certainly do think this fiduciary or long-term mindset changed significantly over the decade. And I think it changed to a point that struck me as very irresponsible and unethical. And that's ultimately why I left the place and the Wall Street.
I want to give a hand for the panel, and then we'll open it up for questions. Thank you. Terrific. The floor is open. Questions can be addressed to all or one of the panelists. And Julia.
Yeah, I have a couple.
Speak up, please, so
sure.
People can hear you.
So I just wanted to ask Greg Smith, and this is kind of an Occupy sort of question, I apologize if it's rude, what not you now, but back in the day, what were you worth? I'm not going to ask what you were paid, although it may very well be in the book, but what do you think, if banking went back to quote-unquote doing it right, if they went back to being boring and allocating capital to its most efficient and productive uses, what is that a person working in that sector worth in comparison to sort of the average worker in the United States? So that would be my first question. And then I have to make a comment to Jeff and Marianne. I find the anti-statism of, we'll call it the left, or of the progressive part of our political spectrum really self-defeating. And I don't know how we can expect anything to change or how to put any real pressure to bear on these large financial institutions and this overweighted financial sector if we just sort of cede that the rules are going to be written by the bankers, and there's a revolving door, and everybody's sort of corrupt and self-interested. Bankers have been writing the rules of the financial system and the regulation of the financial system since the beginning of the 20th century. They call critics of the Federal Reserve don't call it, you know, the bastard creature from Jekyll Island for nothing. Stock exchanges are self-regulating organizations, and even worse now, they spun off. They're now for-profit. The stock exchanges are now profit. For-profit corporations, and they spun off their regulatory functions, so it's like even worse than it was before. So the banking system's always regulated itself and written its own rules. But that didn't mean that we've had these kinds of calamitous.
Wrap it up.
Okay. It doesn't mean that we've had these sort of calamitous cycles of boom and bust. It doesn't mean that we've had haven't had periods of boring finance where finance worked better for the macro economy. And obviously there needs to be tax policy. Obviously there needs to be industrial policy. Obviously I completely agree with Jeff that part of the solution has to be about luring, and the state has a role to play in luring and incentivizing capital to go back to doing boring things that are productive in the real economy. But yeah, I think that there's a problem when we just sort of get so very skeptical and pessimistic about banking regulation. And I agree with Greg that the Volcker Rule, if properly written and applied, would do quite a lot. It's been in place before. It worked in the past.
I'm going to actually collect comments so that we hear from the audience before you get to respond. Okay, so take notes. Hands. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. Yes, I was on the working group, the mechanics group of OWS, and I worked on the models and worked on the business plan and was going to be on the board, which we'd announced when Sheila Bair spoke at Columbia. And Kathy O'Neill, I believe that's her name, brought, and my colleague, let me think of his name, I'm sorry. In any event, Sheila Bair came and spoke with us, and she sits on one of the Pew Foundation or something like that, and was talking about her book, and I arrived late and was not, and I'm an experienced financial sector analyst, experienced bank analyst for well over 20 years, but was a whistleblower. So my question, however, was not at all taken, and everybody else's question, who really didn't have any direct Wall Street experience, who could have really asked her a very tough question. All of their questions were taken, but to speak to your issues, and I thank you, because you actually did make a very correct comment that derivatives perhaps really should not be permitted, nor especially not traded. They got a special carve out to prevent oversight at all. And if you really do understand safe and sound banking practices, you're right in your observation that have a financial sector and banks providing goods and services to the customers is really the model, and the regulators really were supportive of that. I did a Basel III comment. I did a Volcker Rule comment, there's a number of pages on me on the internet and public comment to FASB on salient issues that the banks themselves have been able to completely thwart. So if you really understand the issues in the financial sector, to return actually to banks where the Volcker Rule really in a way wouldn't need to be just getting rid of derivatives and the ability to trade them, you know, because they've inflated their balance sheets, and it brings that complexity that you said is really abusive.
Thank you. So. As they say on Jeopardy, question form, please. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I promise I have a question.
Good. Speak up, please.
Okay. Thank you guys for taking the time to speak to us. It's an important topic that obviously affects everyone in the world.
Sure. You guys have painted a pretty grim picture. Protest is suppressed, government is incompetent, and the banking industry is taking advantage of its clients. So I guess the last form of protest is in consumerism, right? It's in how we choose to spend our money. So I guess my question is there an alternative, short of banking going back to boring practices, to wealth accumulation for the average consumer and lending for the average consumer?
Thank you. Couple more questions, and then we'll turn to the panel, and then we will wrap it up. Right over here in the red coat.
You mentioned one that you thought there should be or cameras and people talking about some of these issues. I'm curious if you're currently involved in any movement building beyond talking about your book to build, you know, like a public coalition and to do actions. I also want to add that I've done some work with the Occupy Wall Street Bank Justice Group. We've done actions in the past, and we're thinking about doing one in the spring related to the fact that the statute of limitations is coming up on a lot of these crimes. So I'm curious if you're already doing some of that, or if you're not, maybe you want to come and talk with us.
Great question. We'll take those three in the back, Bridget, any three in any order. If you can be brief, so we can get a response and then call it.
Two quick questions. First, why wasn't Brown Brothers Harriman implicated in any of these scandals? they were very big in the beginning of the century, but you know, I didn't hear them mentioned at all.
Private company.
What's your second question?
The second question is, we've been through a number of economic transitions. Numerous credible people have said that we're in a transition period now, and it's just not clear what we're transitioning toward. How would you compare the transition that we're in now with the one that we faced at the beginning of the 20th century, the one we faced when Jackson and Nicholas Biddle were fighting over the renewal of the United States Bank? How does our current period compare with those?
Good.
Thank you very much to the panel. I have a couple questions I actually want to address is the topic of economists. There are quite a few economists that are, I would consider them industry economists that work in, say, transportation, commercial real estate, and other industries. And they have been actually outspoken about what they see is going on in the financial industry and also in the composition of these investments. It's a part of the industry of what I do, so I listen to them all the time. But I notice that they do not get a lot of coverage from the media, and oftentimes their voices are unheard, even though they are outspoken. So something I think would be important is to somehow get them into the conversation. And I think it would also be helpful for the general public to better understand how does economics actually work, and then use that information to implement. So my question to the panel is, how do we increase the economic knowledge of the general public so that they have a better perspective on what's going on?
Thank you. So last question, and then we'll turn back to the panel and then call it a night.
Greg, you've kind of described what seems to me the halcyon days of the finance industry when things were better regulated and wealth was more equitably distributed. And I'm curious how this account addresses the fundamental socioeconomic iniquities that predate the systemic origins of the recent crisis. And if it doesn't, I'm curious why not.
Wow. So we're going to start at that end, and you can respond to any at your end. Anything or all, so that we end with Greg, and the floor is yours, Jeff, for a brief response to any or all.
I'll try to be fast. On the last question, I kind of thought we were addressing that, frankly, but...
Can you speak into your
mic? I thought we were addressing that. I may not have understood the last question. On the Biddle, Jackson, and turn-of-the-century questions, those were bank questions. We created the Federal Reserve. I assume you're referring to that after the huge crisis of the early 1900s. That we ended I think it was the second national bank under Jackson, probably led to problems, complex issues. I think the biggest change now is the banks are much more aggressive institutions than they were, though they were pretty speculative back then. But it's a global issue now. So I think global regulation, global control is probably the new phase, but that's an oversimplification. On Julia's point about rejecting statism, I sympathize with Occupy about, for the very reasons, and I let Marianne address that. But there are many theories of change. Anarchists are not all dumb. Semi-anarchists like James Scott of Yale make very interesting points about how change occurs. Jane Jacobs, in her writing about cities, is to some degree an anarchist. She wants to see 1,000 flowers bloom, not direction from the top. I think it's very frustrating to be a young person and think you'll get much change. I'd like to see some directed programs. I think they have some power and, trying not to pay back student debt and so forth, but civil rights movement and the anti-Vietnam movement, which were, by and large, I was a child and an adolescent for most of that, but became an adult, the Vietnam War lasted and so on, for some of it. They were not well organized. They were disruptive. They caused trouble. People were scared to death of Martin Luther King. The FBI was after him. JFK hesitated to meet him. Bobby Kennedy hesitated to meet with him. Let's keep this history in mind. We have so suppressed protest in this country, we forgot what it's about. We've become such a conservative country. And one last bit of optimism. Could the Consumer Protection Bureau that was godmothered, let's say, by Elizabeth Warren and is now run by one of her proteges, could do a lot of good. That could be an effective regulatory body. If we stopped all those darn fraudulent loans to people who couldn't possibly understand them, and that includes virtually everybody in this room, maybe even Greg, if we stopped them early on, a lot of that crisis would have been at least reduced substantially in size, and a bureau like that would have done that.
Thank you.
And as for economics education, I just have to say this. Beware of economics education. I mean, look at poor Greg. He got first year economics from John Taylor, for God's sakes. Guy would have us in recession, right? Forgive me, Greg.
You're a better friend of mine than him. I know you better.
In any case, let me...
Thank you.
You're right in many respects, but economics education can be quite ambiguous, too.
Marianne.
Yeah, so I'll just respond to the really technical economics.
Use your microphone, please.
To respond to your point, I mean, why do people... Why are they recalcitrant about working through normal governmental channels? I think it's important to recognize that that's not an ideological position. That's something that's garnered from experience. So, for example, I'm actually Canadian, and we have an actual socialist party in Canada. And every time they get into power, they quash unions and implement austerity measures. And you know, it's the same thing is going on in Europe. People have lost faith with electoral politics because they've discovered that those things are not fruitful avenues for pursuing the aims, political and economic, that they want to pursue. And I think that it is actually absolutely important. I love what you said about remembering our own political history and remembering that, you know, I mean, that is why the civil rights movement in the 60s took the forms that it did, because look, this change wasn't going to happen on a legislative level.
After disruptive
exactly.
protests.
Exactly.
You have to believe
Yeah, well,
I think that that's what people are trying to do in Occupy, is bring that kind of pressure from the ground level up. I think that the point you raised, which, let me rephrase it this way, is raising the larger question of the massive transfer of wealth that's been taking place over the last, let's say, 40 years, which Occupy was also very good at bringing to light, to the 1%, to the wealthiest sector of the country. The financial industry is only one aspect of that story. There's also the story of how productivity has been increasing in this country while wages have been staying flat, if not decreasing. So I think that's absolutely an important discussion to be had, and part of what Occupy's mandate was in exposing and talking about and politicizing as an issue. And I'll just leave it there.
Thank you. Greg, last word.
Okay. I'll try to tackle almost everything in very brief terms. First one: What are people in finance actually worth? And I'll tell you, I was a mid-level person. I was a vice president. Relative to anyone else in the country or the world, I was making a significant amount of money. And I talk about it in the book. I talk about my own reflections on making money at a young age, on how the money was being made. I go into quite explicit detail about it. What I would say is there's also a difference on Wall Street where there, what I'd call the 1% within Wall Street banks are at times making between 10 to 50 to 100 times what the people, what I'd call the soldiers or the people in the trenches are making. And that's one of the things I think is very problematic with the system, is it is set up to create this almost incentive for the people who are the foot soldiers to try to become the people at the top 1% who are getting all the money that is being extracted from this lack of transparency and complexity. And people start valuing themselves at things that are not in line with reality. So, you know, when I go into what's called bonus day on Wall Street, where you know, you see things like people storming out of the office or slamming doors or leaving because you know, they got paid 12% less than the previous year, and then you ask, well, this partner who stormed out of the office, that meant they went from $10 million to $8.8 million. And, you know, the more you see things like this, it makes you realize, and I certainly now realize to a very great extent, that this is a crazy inflated bubble. I would say go back to the 1970s and the 1980s to get evidence of what the boring banking business valued people at. And bankers have always, you know, banking has existed for centuries, but they weren't making tens of millions of dollars until this decade that we've just been through. And that was largely based on, I think, the deregulation that allowed just the example of Goldman Sachs revenues quintupling in 5 years. And, you know, $500,000 or $200,000 or $300,000 is a huge amount of money relative to anyone in the country. But when now people are expecting $10 million and $20 million and $50 million, it's its own compensation bubble, which eventually will burst when, you know, one hopes this is fixed in other ways, but when we enter into another crisis, which this previous crisis was driven by this very problem, which was everyone wanted the bigger bonus. They knew they were not going to go to jail for doing things that were still technically legal, and they kept doing them until the system ended. And that's the reality we live in today. Second question about what can consumers do, like how can people today generate a return? And what I would say is, as long as things like high-frequency trading exist, now, for people who don't know, high-frequency trading is basically, there have been legal loopholes which have allowed certain people to put computers on stock exchanges that get them access to the stocks 0.2 milliseconds before anyone else. And 60 Minutes has done a special on this, and this is something that is not well understood by the public, yet accounts for more than 60% of everything that's traded on the New York Stock Exchange goes through these automatic algorithms that are generating profits for people, largely because, you know, front running is a word certain people have used. They're getting to the trade a millisecond before any of us could do an e-trade. And that's problematic, and it's why, you know, my personal view is it's hard to make a case for investing in the stock market today because it's at 7-year highs. We've seen through things like the flash crash that it's very unstable, and this is being caused by high-frequency trading. So unless you're in it for 20 years, or and the economists here can give a much better sense of this, it's hard to say that it's a very tradable market when it's not well understood by the public. The next thing I would say, what have I done to get people together other than talking about my book? And certainly my goal with the book, and the only reason I wrote it, is I found a publisher who allowed me to do it exactly the way I wanted, which was not have my hand forced into being dishonest about the true reality of what goes on. So I try to show the good things about banking and how it evolved into a lot of bad things. And my goal with it was to try to pull back the curtain for people to read it and have a true understanding, or my own opinion of what Wall Street is. And I would say to you, I've gotten more than 4,000 messages from people in the public, and a lot of what I'm trying to do is bring all the sentiments I've heard together. And I've heard from hundreds of people within the industry who feel this way, you know, but are feel trapped in a system that they don't really know how to get out of. I've heard from probably more people outside of the financial industry who talk more about these macro issues of how the system is, just the whole governmental system is rigged, and the average consumer does not have a strong enough hand in fixing things like health insurance or kids being fed you know, unusually unhealthy things at school or defense budgets. So what I would like to do and what I'm trying to do is get a sense for what all these conflicts of interest are. And one of the reasons I enjoy doing these speeches is, like, speaking to lots of people can help inform me and others what is the best way to bring to light these conflicts. And I think by talking about them is one thing. But another important thing, I think, is whistleblowers. And I mean true whistleblowers. You know, people in this room may know that there's a thing called a whistleblower fund at the SEC, and they have a budget of $400 million to pay to people for bringing to light crimes. And to date, I think less than $50,000 have been paid out. There've been hundreds of things submitted, but the SEC says they just don't have the resources to go through them. So there've been some politicians who read the book, and I've been in dialogue with some of them. And if I can help explain to them things like, well, you know, the Volcker rule that Jamie Dimon is telling you is unnecessary because of hedging and market making, I would like to be part of a group from within Wall Street who explains how the wool is being pulled over Congress people's eyes. Meaning, it's not a very easy thing to explain that market making means you're doing what the client wants. It's not you using the client to do what you want. And proprietary trading is very much going on today. It's just being called market making. And, you know, that's not an easy thing to explain to the public, but I'm trying to be part of that dialogue of explaining to regulators and legislators how this argument that if we pass these rules, the market will be destroyed is just not true. America will always be the most liquid, stable market in the world, in my opinion. And I think the fear is that people will move to Europe or banks will go to Asia. In my strong opinion, if the U.S. took a stand and did things right, I think the rest of the world would have to follow because the size of the market is so much bigger. Why was Brown Brothers Harriman not implicated? I think this is a very important issue. Brown Brothers Harriman is still a private company, and Goldman Sachs was the very last private company that became a public partnership. Now, the reason private companies are less systemically dangerous to society is because the partners' interests are tied up in making good long-term decisions. So as soon as Goldman Sachs went public, the very last of the big banks, the partners just cash out every few years, and they are not incentivized to make long-term decisions. They're not incentivized to turn away toxic business. And a lot of people say, well, maybe we should privatize the banks again. And that's going to be a hard thing to do, to kind of reverse this whole thing that's taken place. The very impetus of which was this whole banking giant supermarket where everyone thought you needed to do everything. You needed to do retail banking, trading. And as soon as Glass-Steagall was overturned, everyone wanted to be part of that business. And I remember clearly when I joined Goldman Sachs, there was real fear that Goldman Sachs was just going to disappear because they weren't big enough to compete with Citigroup and J.P. Morgan, and therefore they went public. And the rest is history. And, you know, some people made good decisions, some people made bad. The problem is these decisions all directly impact society, whereas when companies are private, shareholders are not involved. The size of their balance sheets are a tenth of the size. They don't have access to the same capital. So I would say that's a big part of the problem. Two other things I would say. If anyone hasn't seen the movie Inside Job, I thought that was one of the most effective documentaries about explaining in clear-eyed terms. A guy, filmmaker named Charles Ferguson, he won an Oscar for it. But it explains, I think, how economists can be helpful to the process, but also how they can be detrimental to the process. And there's a particular story about Iceland, how I think it might be actually, I can't remember who it was, but there's some prominent deans of schools in New York who were involved in pushing, not at this school, much lesser institutions, that were involved in telling the public everything was okay, and those people were getting paid a fee in order to do that, and that's a conflict of interest in and of itself. On the flip side, economists could be hugely helpful if they publish unconflicted things, which I think what you need for that is you need a financial media who is not complicit in carrying on the problem. And that's why I think we should be quite angry at the financial media for not doing a better job uncovering things. And just as we should be angry at the Justice Department for really not effectively prosecuting something that destroyed a third of the world's wealth. So I think that's very problematic. And the thing I'll end on is, you know, we think of Enron and we think of the internet bubble and we think of all sorts of systems that exist. And then, you know, even if you look back at scandals from the 70s, the 80s, and then you look back on them and you say, well, like this was egregiously illegal. Like how did this go on? Yet in the moment, these things seem acceptable because people are willing to push the line up to what will not get them sent to jail. And that's why I think, you know, you can talk about people who believe or don't believe in regulation, but if everyone's driving race cars and there are no rules, people are just going to drive as fast as they can until they crash into each other. And I think, unfortunately, the government missed an opportunity with the biggest crisis since the Great Depression to really take a strong hand and take tough medicine and cause, allow banks to protest at being broken up. But unfortunately, like I think we've all somewhat agreed, the system has effectively continued as it was. There's just less competition than there was before the crisis. And ironically, one of the biggest enemies of change is the fact that stock market is at 7-year highs and the Obama administration can point at slightly decreasing unemployment, which I think my hope and I think many people's hope is that this just doesn't recede into memory, because I think that really endangers us for a cycle of crises. So that's where I'll leave my comments.
Thank you, Greg. I think markets must be opening in Tokyo. Greg's just getting going here. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Bridget and the Schwartz Center. And I really want to thank the panelists and Greg Smith, most of all.